Friends, death contemplation is daily Buddhist routine. The Blessed Buddha once said about this. Bhikkhus and friends, contemplation on death, when developed and frequently practiced, brings high reward and blessing, has a deathless dimension itself, as gold and sweet fruit. And how so? Bhikkhus and friends, at every dawn and every dusk, the wise bhikkhu thinks to himself, truly there are many possibilities of dying. A snake may bite me, or a scorpion, or a centipede may sting me, and thereby I may lose my life. This would be an obstruction for reaching lasting happiness. Or I may stumble and fall down, or I may become seriously sick, or bad men or evil spirits may attack me, and thereby I may die. That would indeed be for me an obstruction, blocking approach, and access to the deathless state of Nibbana. Here, a bhikkhu therefore considers by intelligent reflection, are there still found in me unsubdued and evil disadvantageous mental states that if I should die today or tonight would lead me to a bad, painful, low, ugly, poor, painful or unsuccessful next life? Now, if he by such reflection realize that indeed still are unsubdued, evil and detrimental mental states found in him, then he should use his utmost determination, energetic effort, endurance, steady awareness, and clear comprehension in order to subdue these evil and disadvantageous mental states. If, however, the bhikkhu by reflection notices that are not any more found in him any evil and disadvantageous mental states, then such bhikkhu can dwell in pure, blissful, serene joy, training himself in advantageous things and states, both by day and by night. Source: Anguttara Nikaya, 874. Friends, the thorn that is life is that it is short, difficult, unknown, yet surely lethal. The problem of life is thus this assured, an inevitable death. Friends, remembering this death as daily Buddhist routine, the Blessed Buddha once said about this, just as the mighty Himalayan mountain are high or expensive and weighing heavily, just so do aging and death suppress and defeat all beings in this fragile world. Whether divine, rich, warrior, priest, trader, slave or sweeper, not sparing anyone, whosoever, crushing anybody that is found. This is the most precious altar in our temple, this body that dies. Soon this fragile body will fall to the ground, lifeless, cast aside, unconscious, stiff, cold, and useless like a rotten log of wood. Momentary. Whosoever knows this body to be as temporary as a bubble, as insubstantial as a mirror image, make, break Mara's honey-tipped arrows, and can thus not be seen by this evil king of death. Big surprise! Death carries off the folly man while he's still distracted by gathering various flowers of sensual pleasures. Even so, as a huge tsunami ray runs all over and carries away the sleeping village. In the ultimate sense, beings have only a very short moment to live. Only as long as one single moment of consciousness lasts. Just as the cartwheel is rolling forward, as in standing still, in every moment rest merely on one point of its rim. Just so does any life of any being last only one single moment of consciousness itself. As soon as this moment is gone, that momentary being is also all gone. One is therefore reborn millions of times in each second. For as it was said by the ancient elders, all life and all existence here is blinking and momentary. All its life engaged involvements, all its joys, dramas, and all its pains depend only on one single, discrete, ever-passing state of mind. And quickly that moment passes by, for never ever to return again. None and nothing is worth clinging to, since it's game over ever and ever and ever again. The Blessed Buddha once said, the days and nights are flying past. Life dwindles hurriedly away. It ticks away. The life of mortals vanishes like water flushes out a tiny stream. Certain future fall. As in the morning one may fear the falling of all the ripened fruits, so do all mortals in this world live in constant fear of death, since they know certain is their future death. Crack up, clay pot. All beings are subject to death, end in death, can never escape death. As every earthenware pot, fashioned by the potter's hand, no matter whether small or great, they will fall and break to pieces in the end. All these clay pots and bodies. Just so are all beings subject to death, end in death, and can never escape death. All beings will have to die. Their life will one day end in death. And they will fare according to their doings, the good and bad fruits they have earned and accumulated. The evildoer fares to hell. The nobleman re-arises in a happy world. Hence noble doings you should perform as a safe provision for your next life. For good doings for the next world give to all beings their only support on the other side. On the other side. On the other side. One should often contemplate this inevitable fact of death. Why actually doing this? Because this makes one approach Nibbana, the only deathless destination. Neglecting thinking about death makes one accumulate future rebirth, and therefore also future rounds of aging, decay, sickness, and death. This is us only suffering. Considering death repeatedly is therefore quite advantageous, but initially not exactly pleasant. Death contemplation gradually gives fearlessness of death, and thereby evaporate all other anxieties. Neglecting death contemplation is therefore detrimental, though more dull and pleasant, just like if one is anesthetized. This fact remains. One loses all again and again at the moment of death, including this body. Death itself is painless and should not be feared. It is life itself that is painful and dreadful and thus should be feared. The only way to escape this life and death cycle is not to be reborn. Only that is peace. Only this is freedom. from all future suffering. Only this is the end of all pain. Only such final cessation of samsara is in itself irreversible, lasting happiness. As the Buddha Gautama said, Nibbana Paranang Sukham. Nibbana is highest bliss. This noble way is therefore about stopping the spin. Just like the plane spinning down, crashing. It is stopping this spin of aging, sickness and death. The noble way is about end-making. Ignorance leads to karma. Karma leads to rebirth, aging, sickness and death. Understanding of the Four Noble Truth ends karma. Ending karma ends rebirth, aging, sickness and death. And thus ends all suffering. The Blessed Buddha once pointed out, the life of mortals here is difficult, brief, unknown, without guarantees, and is always joined with the inherent misery of aging, decay, sickness and death. For there is no chance, no possibility that one born will not die. To die is the nature of all beings. Just as the ripe fruit, there is constantly a fear of falling. Even so do all beings also constantly fear death. Just as clay pots all break up sooner or later, even so is the life of all mortals. Whether young or old, foolish or wise, all of them, will surely die. When they are overcome by death, going from here to the next existence, no one, neither father, son or family, can protect the mortal who is led away like the cow to be slaughtered. And that even while the wailing relatives are actually looking on. The world is irreversibly infected by death, sickness and old age. Knowing this as an unavoidable absolute, wise men do not grieve, but accept this very fact just as it is. Lamenting over a mortal is gone, has died, is utterly useless. Whose past one cannot know, seeing neither from where he came, nor where he is going, cannot be helped by any moaning, crying, or lamenting. All wise can realize that lamentation just harms oneself. This sorrow serves no good purpose. All this is true, whether it's oneself or another who's dying. Weeping won't help. Friends, anybody is a dying bag of bones. All formations, all constructions, mental as physical, are truly transient. It is their very nature to arise and cease right there where they arose. Having arisen, these captivating, discreet mental states instantly pass away right there. The calming, stilling, and ceasing of these momentary appearances is happiness. Therefore, even in the present, every being dies millions of times per second. So also will they die in any possible future, and so have they always died. In the same way then, I shall surely die. There's no doubt about this in me. Uncertain is life, but certain is death. I shall surely die. Death will be the termination of my life. Life is very insecure, but death is sure. death is certain. Not long, alas, this my beloved puppet-like body will lie as frozen upon the earth, rejected, smelling, void of consciousness, disgusting as a useless, rotten log of wood. This very body, from the skin, soles of the feet to the crown of the head, is just a bag of bones surrounded by skin, full of various mean foul impurities, such as head hair, body hair, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, marrows, kidney, heart, liver, membranes, spleen, lungs, bowel, intestines, slime, excrement, brain, bile, lymph, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tears, tallow, spit, snot, joint fluid, and stinking urine. Just a bag of bones, flesh, and skin. A rotten heap of suffering. A rotten heap of suffering. Keeping this precious and very realistic imagery in mind, will then gradually reduce and weaken these violent lusts and voracious greeds and uncontrollable wandering desires that attract beings into self-destructive forms of suffering, such as pornomania, pedophilia, HIV-transmitting sexuality, overeating, abuse of drugs, alcohols and pills, all addictions to the manifold and diverse forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions, and variants of doped consciousness. All this, though fascinating, remains just an ensnaring, enthralling suffering, disguised as pleasure and satisfaction. Friends, aging reproduces the same suffering ever and ever again. Aging is suffering. And what is aging? Whatever decay, decrepitude, broken teeth, graying of hair, wrinkling of skin, decline of strength, weakening of the mental abilities, feebleness and senility of whatever kind of being that is called aging. Its function is to lead on to death. It is manifested as the vanishing of youth. It is suffering because of the change into decay and the gradual but steadily falling apart of the body, the loss of memory and intelligence into senile dementia. It's distressing. Malignness in every limb, with every ability declining, with vanishing of youthfulness, with memory all evaporated, with intelligence eroded away, with strength now drained, with growing unattractiveness, now looking and smelling bad to both wife, friends and family. This is an unavoidable misery any mortal must expect to find. Since aging is what all this will bring, aging is well designated as suffering. Friends, the inevitable and ever-returning problem, death. All health ends in sickness. All youth ends in aging. All life ends in assured death. All worldly beings begin with birth, is haunted by aging, surprised by sickness, and struck down by death, often in a state of desperate panic and frantic fear. How short is this life? You die on this side of a century, but even if you live more than 100 years, you die of old age. Aging and death is thus an ever-recurring nasty surprise for anyone who habitually lives in complacency. For anyone who habitually lives in complacency, death carries off the man while he is still distracted by gathering flowers of sensual pleasures. Death sweeps away the man distracted while he not yet had his fill of sensual pleasures, even as he gathers these flowers. Exactly as a cowherd drives the cows forward, exactly even so do aging, sickness and death drive all beings towards the end. But those who listen and act accordingly, when the depth of the Dhamma is revealed, they indeed cross beyond this realm of death, so hard to overcome. Neither in the distant space, nor in the deepest ocean, nor in the darkest cave can anyone escape this crushing fact of death. The man who understands this inevitable death, if clever, lives morally pure, while keenly clearing this great urge, his path to Nirvana approaches. This body is always worn out, a fragile form, a nest of disease, a rotting mass of deception, since his life surely and always ends in decay and death. A bag of bones, like withered leaves scattered by the autumn wind. Are these pale and whitened bones? What happiness can there ever be in them? My precious and adored body. It is a bag held off by bones, plastered with skin, full of blood and flesh. In it lives only aging, sickness, death, pride, and petty self-deceit. The Blessed Buddha once said, while alive, then he's untroubled, and when he dies too, then he's not worried. A recluse who has seen the goal lives undisturbed, even in this sorrowful world. Wherever he goes, there he's unafraid. Wherever he sleeps, there he's unalarmed. The nights and days does neither touch nor burn him. He sees nothing in this world that is to be kept lost. Therefore his mind dwells in goodwill and gentle kindness to all beings until he falls asleep. Here he rejoices, so after death he rejoices. The one having done good works rejoices both places. Remembering, looking back, seeing and thinking, oh, I have done good works, well done. He enjoys the bliss of the happy worlds even more. Whoever never injures with weapon nor stick, being searching for the happiness when after this death, seeking the same happiness, such clever and kind one, always find it. The friend who returns from a long journey is welcomed back by his family and friends. Even and exactly so when the doer of good at death passes to the next state, then his merits receives him, awaits him, like friends and family. The homeless sages, always restrained in both action and body, finally pass to the deathless state, where sorrow is not. Having so gone to the far shore of being, mind is freed from all attachment, from any substrate of existence, and never returns to birth, aging, or death. The one who has no longings, who fully understands, who is without doubt, who is established, immersed in the deathless state, such one I call a holy one. Thank you.